morning. Welcome to worship this morning. We're so very glad to have you gathered with us today, no matter where it is that you might be tuning in from. My name is Hillary Downs, and I'm one of the pastors here at First Presbyterian Church in Salida, Colorado, and I have the gift of serving here alongside Tom Abbott. And today, we all have a special gift of having Mike Arill with us. Mike is the former pastor here and my former colleague in ministry, so we're really pleased to have him with us today. So thank you, Mike, for joining us. This is a special day, a celebration, as today we celebrate that we've paid off our debt for this new sanctuary and the whole new part of the building that we built 6 years ago, and we're going to burn the mortgage right here, live. Well, with the continued high count of COVID-19 cases in our county, our session voted on Tuesday night to continue with online-only worship through December 20th. They'll meet again that week of December 20th to decide on the two Sundays after that. On Christmas Eve, we're going to be offering a service that will be streamed online, but also we'll be offering a brief in-person outdoor service that's in our parking lot. So there are going to be four time slots that you can choose from that night. Space is limited in each one, so you need to sign up for a time slot. And you can do that either by clicking the link that's in the email that you've been sent and will get sent again, or by calling the church office and we'll get you signed up for that. Well, today on this third Sunday in Advent, we continue our look at the men and women from the story of Christ's birth and how they experienced everything that happened then. And today we're taking a little closer look at Joseph. So hear these words as they come to us from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1. Now the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother, Mary, had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband, Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit.
She will bear a son,
and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins.
All this took place to fulfill
what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us.
When Joseph awoke from sleep,
he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son. And he named him Jesus.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And let us begin our time of worship in prayer.
Let's join our hearts together and pray.
God of grace and light,
we give you thanks today for this day of celebration where we can gather as we can to worship you, one in spirit.
We thank you, Lord, for the
gift of technology, as imperfect as we may find it to be. We give you thanks for the beauty of the snowfall that has come to our dry lands. We give you thanks for this beautiful season where we remember the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to earth to live among us and to show us your way, who came to live for us, to die for us, and who rose for us.
God, we also come to you with the recognition that there have been times this week when we have failed
to walk in your way.
Times when we have not sought peace,
when we have not acted in love and justice and mercy, and we regret that.
We pray for your grace
to wash over us, and to make us new and renew our hearts.
God, as we go deeper
in this time of worship, we pray that you would illumine our minds and our hearts to your word, that it would soak deep into our souls
and change us from the inside out. And we pray all of this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. Our second scripture reading in the life of Joseph comes after the birth of Jesus,
after the wise men from the east had come and had visited the Christ child, and after those wise men are headed home. And here is what happened. From Matthew chapter 2, this is verses 13 through 23.
Now, after they had left,
an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you. For Herod is about to search for the child, to destroy him.
Then Joseph got up,
took the child and his mother by night, and went to Egypt, and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Out of Egypt I call my son.
When Herod saw that
he had been tricked by the wise men, he was infuriated, and he sent and killed all the children in and around Bethlehem who were 2 years old or under, according to the time that he had learned from the wise men.
Then was fulfilled what had been
spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. A voice was heard in Ramah, wailing in loud lamentation, Rachel weeping for her children. She refused to be consoled because they are no more.
When Herod died,
an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared in a dream to Joseph in Egypt and said, get up, take the child and his mother, and go to the land of Israel, for those who were seeking the child's life are dead.
Then Joseph got up,
took the child and his mother, and went to the land of Israel.
But when he heard that Archelaus
was ruling over Judea in the place of his father Herod, he was afraid to go.
And after being warned in a dream,
he went away to the district of Galilee.
There he made his home
in a town called Nazareth, so that what had been spoken through the prophets might be fulfilled, he would call the Nazarene.
Amen. Lighting our Advent
wreath today are Jerry and Carolyn Vandenbosch. So I'm going to invite them forward and we're going to turn the camera to them.
Today, we relight the first and second Advent candles, the candles of hope and love. And we light the third Advent candle, the candle of joy. Why do we call this candle the candle of joy? Because, above all, Christmas is a season of joy. Joy at the birth of baby Jesus. Joy that God loves us so much to become one of us. Joy that Jesus has not left us forever, but promised to come back. No wonder the angel said to the shepherds, I bring you good news of great joy. And there are lots of other reasons to be joyful at Christmas, too.
Yes, there are.
Shortly after Jesus was born, his family had to flee Israel, becoming refugees in Egypt.
When we consider Jesus' life, we realize that joy comes in faithfully following God, even when the road seems dangerous, difficult, or painful. Because the joy of bringing healing transformation to the world is anything but an easy road. What greater joy can any of us know than the joy of participating in God's healing in the world? At Christmas, we celebrate that this path of
healing all started with the joy of the baby Jesus' birth.
And that is the most important thing to keep in mind in all the busy activities of Christmas. Let's all pray. Dear God, we thank you for the joy you brought to us in Jesus' birth at Christmas. Help us to make our world more joyful by the love we show to others at Christmas, all through you.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I am very honored to sort of be with you today. As we experience this very special Sunday and in your role as preacher today, it's really sort of hard for me to believe that it's been almost 4 years since I last preached. And I'm bummed that we couldn't be together in person, but I completely understand. I am still very excited to be with you, even if it is only on Facebook. And I told them at the early service, I have to give Tom and Hillary and musicians and others who are leading worship services just my greatest compliments. This is really strange to be speaking to an almost empty sanctuary. They've been doing this for months,
and doing it well. And I think that wherever you are today, that offer a prayer of thanksgiving to God for, I'm going to just say heroic efforts, because I think they are, for what they've done to keep the church alive and active during this time.
You know, during times like
these, strange and difficult as they are, you have to find something to laugh about, or you should go crazy. So, the other night, Bev and I were watching the NBC Nightly News, and they were having a segment about kids and how they were handling COVID, especially how kids were handling going to school on Zoom. And I'm assuming that everybody by this point knows what Zoom is, and we just had a congregational meeting on Zoom, so I think you all know what that is. But anyway, Lester Holt asked a young girl how she felt about going to school on Zoom, and she answered without hesitation and with a lot of energy, "Yuck, I hate poopy Zoom."
So poopy Zoom or not,
or poopy Facebook as the case may be, it is very good to be with you this morning on this Spur the Mortgage Sunday.
This is actually my
third Burn the Mortgage. The first was back in the early 90s when we burned the note for the educational wing that was built by one of my predecessors.
And then the second one
was in the early 2000s when we had burned the note for a fairly significant building renovation and also adding on a library and a classroom and a bathroom. But this one is the biggest one of all.
You are celebrating
the completion of a project that has its roots back in 2010, and you've done something that a lot of people really didn't think could be done.
And so I am very grateful
to Hillary and to Tom and to the session for inviting me to be a part of this really significant moment that finds its culmination here today.
The theological task
for me today, for today's sermon, is to somehow connect the Joseph story, read to us earlier, with the building project. I know that you are in the midst of an Advent series where you've been looking at some of the major players in the birth story of Jesus. So the first week, I believe you had Elizabeth and Zachariah. Last week, Hillary preached on Mary. And when Tom told me that Joseph was going to fall on the Sunday that I was to preach, I wasn't really very thrilled at first. I mean, after all, what does Joseph have to do with burning mortgages? And Tom did tell me that I could choose another passage if I wanted to. But I got to thinking and decided that Joseph is actually a perfect story for today's celebration. And I promise that I will get to the Joseph story eventually toward the end of the sermon, and it will make some sense. But here at the start, I would like us to spend a little bit of time walking down memory lane.
In 2010,
our church was in the midst of a growth spurt. We had lots of our own groups meeting in the building. We had lots of community groups meeting and more asking to use the space all the time. We had a full schedule of ministries for children and youth and adults. I think every day of the week except for Saturday was jam-packed, and even Saturdays sometimes were full. So space was at a premium. And even the space that we had some inadequacies.
On top of that,
we were holding three worship services every Sunday at 8, 9:30, and 11 a.m. And we felt that was necessary because our old sanctuary, as beautiful as it was, and as much as we all loved it, was beginning to feel sort of cramped, or as some would affectionately say, cozy.
However, the amount of effort it took
to keep three worship services going every Sunday was exhausting. At least I was exhausted. Hillary handled that schedule a whole lot better than I did, for which I'm thankful, because it added a little bit of sanity to the morning.
But I was also
beginning to feel disconnected from the congregation, because Sunday morning always felt so rushed in between services, and there never seemed to be enough time to sit down with people and to relax and just be together.
And the number of volunteers
that it took to keep three worship services going was staggering, and it was unsustainable.
So I started suggesting
the possibility of going back to two services, and the session called a congregational meeting to discuss the issue. After a long discussion, two services or three, the congregation finally voted to keep all three services. I was really disappointed.
But at that meeting,
one of our members, Jim Snow, as I remember it, stood up and suggested that maybe it would be a good idea to put together a building committee to explore our facility needs. And the session thought that was a good idea, and so the committee was formed with Bob Miller as its chair. And we had a really good committee with an incredible depth of passion, faith, and competencies and experience. And I wish I could name every one of them. I would probably forget. I know Tom's going to name them a little bit later when we burn the mortgage. So I'm not going to name them now, but I want you to know how greatly you are appreciated. What you did for this church will forever be a highlight of my own life. And I truly feel humbled and blessed that I was able to share that experience with you.
So after many months
of lots of meetings, prayer, study, dreaming, conversations, and yes, even a few arguments, the committee came back to the congregation with the recommendation that we needed some new facilities at the cost of somewhere north of $1 million.
And you can almost hear the collective gulp of the congregation with that number.
Is that even possible? We said to ourselves out loud and loudly.
You know, we had a really good track record
up to then on some other big projects, but $1 million. I mean, that sounded crazy to many of us in the small congregation.
But something like 80% of the congregation voted and believed that it was possible. And so the building campaign began. The campaign adopted
an official motto: more room to serve.
Serving
was and is a core value of this congregation.
And so by September
2012, we were ready to break ground. And I remember saying to the congregation at a meeting just a couple of weeks before that first shovel hit the dirt, "So we're really going to do this."
Never had I been
so scared and so hopeful at the same time.
Well, as the saying goes,
be careful what you wish for. If we thought holding three services, worship services, was exhausting, building the building was even more so.
But it was so fun to watch it all take shape. With the expertise of
architect and church member Bob Brether, engineer and church member Ron Mazzeo, builder and church member John Deason,
the project moved
very quickly.
And you'll notice that I
keep saying church member. This would not have happened. This project would simply not have occurred if it wasn't for you, the congregation. This whole thing is here because of what you did. Church members on destruction crews and trash crews, church members on landscape crews, church members painting, providing meals, scrubbing, moving furniture, designing and building the AV system, fundraising, and really so much more than I can even remember. We called all of that sweat equity, which is nothing but a fancy euphemism to say working our tail ends off so we didn't have to spend as much money for somebody else to do all that stuff. And above all things, we pray. Every week, many of us got together in the cold of winter, and we stood in a circle and prayed. Now, we could have gone inside the building and prayed in a warmer space, but we wanted to immerse ourselves a little bit more in the process. And so we prayed outside, on site, first on the bare dirt, then on the concrete slab, then amongst the rafters and the framing. And there were some really cold mornings. But the prayers were warm and full of faith and hope and excitement and dreaming. Before the sheetrock went up, we did a really cool thing. We asked the congregation to write their prayers on the studs. Some of you may not know this, but behind these walls in the sanctuary and the fellowship hall, the bathrooms, everything that we built, there are dozens and dozens of prayers written on those studs by the congregation. Prayers such as, Lord, help us to serve you. Lord, show us how to love. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, may everyone feel welcome here. Or, for God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. Or, may this church be filled with faith, hope, peace, love, joy. The Advent candles, really. Or, bless this city, O Lord. And from the Psalms, unless the Lord builds the house, the builders labor in vain. One young boy wrote, I love Spider-Man. And so, undergirded by prayer, sacrifice, sweat equity, and Spider-Man, this facility was built. And I'll bet you that we are the only church in the world that can say that about Spider-Man. By May of 2014, right on schedule, maybe even a little bit ahead, I don't remember, and pretty close to budget of $1.2 million, we dedicated this new facility to the service of God, this community, and to one another. And we moved in. That was the day. More room to serve. That was our official motto. And it has been fulfilled faithfully and admirably these past 6 years. And will continue to do so once you are able to re-enter the building. That will all happen again. My unofficial motto, though, was, it's not about the building. I'm sure I got a little bit annoying at times by repeating that mantra at almost every meeting and in many sermons. It's not about the building. It's not about the building. It's not about the building. I think I remember Bob Miller saying to me once, but it's a little bit about the building, isn't it? Well, yes, of course it is. But all of us agreed that the building was purposes of God. And I'd like for you to remember that phrase, the redemptive purposes of God. That's where I'd like us to hang out for the remainder of the sermon. And it's where Joseph will finally come into the picture. The redemptive purposes of God. But what are those redemptive purposes? And what does the redemptive purposes of God even mean? Well, just a couple of months after we broke ground, our elders and staff engaged in a visioning process. We used to do that from time to time. And on this particular occasion, I set up a scenario. I said to them, let's pretend that you are starting your own church from scratch. Imagine, what do you want that church to be and to do? So it was a kind of an identity and mission sort of exercise. I was asking them to dream a little about the redemptive purposes of God and their role and the church's role in those purposes. Like Joseph was a dreamer, I asked them to set their imaginations free and to dream of what the church could be. And their responses filled 5 pages single-spaced and were incredibly inspiring. I still have those responses on a flash drive that I saved when I retired, and I brought them out again and looked them over in preparation for this sermon. And we don't have all the time to go through all 5 pages, but some of the responses were that we wanted the church to be Jesus-centered, Spirit-led, filled with prayer, and biblically literate. We wanted a church that would be grace-filled, where every person who entered these doors would feel abundantly welcome, with nobody left out and nobody ignored. We wanted to be a risk-taking church, a creative, always challenging ourselves to new things. We wanted to be an extravagantly generous church in terms of our time and our talents and our money. They wanted a church where everyone could be their authentic selves, no mask, figuratively or literally. No mask, no judgment, that they could be who they were. They dreamed of a church that would be filled with humility and mercy, forgiveness and compassion, a church that would be a light in our community, serving the real needs of real people in the real world. What they wanted was a Matthew 25 church. You remember those passages? A church that would feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, take care of the sick, visit the prisoner, welcome the stranger. They wanted to be an Isaiah 58 and 65 church, a little bit more obscure, but that would be a church that sheltered the homeless, freed the oppressed, loosed the bonds of injustice, and healed the nations. They wanted their church to comfort those who grieved and to reconcile those who felt broken. They wanted the church to be countercultural, by which they meant a church that did not have the hatreds and prejudices so common in our society today. Someone said poetically that they wanted the church to be a refreshing stream where weary travelers could come and drink. In other words, they wanted a church that would serve the redemptive purposes of God. All of those dreams of human thriving that I just described, and many more that we could if we sat down together for a long time, all of those dreams of thriving illustrate the redemptive purposes of God. and serving those redemptive purposes is the only reason the church exists. Serving the redemptive purposes of God is the foundational motivation for everything the church does, from its worship services, to its fellowship, to its potlucks, to its classes, to its youth groups, to its mission trips, to its building projects. Every decision made is made with that goal in mind, serving the redemptive purposes of God. And that at last brings us to Joseph. Joseph was a man who more than anything else wanted to serve the redemptive purposes of God. That was his chisel that shaped everything that he did, his values. It was the light that guided his daily choices. You know that Joseph was a builder, a carpenter, who made useful things that would help people thrive. And I see that as a metaphor for us. Lord, help us to help your world thrive. Help us to build that kind of a world in a small way, right here. Joseph is described as a righteous man, a man who tried to do the right things always, like staying with Mary, even though at first he thought she had cheated on him. He was a protector of the vulnerable and the innocent, as seen in the way he cared for and guided and guarded Mary and the baby Jesus from the paranoid king who wanted to do murder. He was a humble man, knowing that life was not all about him. And maybe most of all, Joseph was a dreamer. Several times in the stories that Hillary read for us, we heard that. And God said to Joseph in a dream. He was a dreamer. Like his Old Testament counterpart, the New Testament Joseph dreamed of the redemptive purposes of God and his role in them. So as I close, you know, I think, or you should know, that the church's vision statement is God's dream for the world, nothing less. It's right there in your website under the tab that says About. And if you haven't spent time there, spend some time there, because there's a lot of documentation there with some really good stuff. God's dream for the world, nothing less. And that dream begins with the good news that you and I, and all of the earth, and everyone in it, no exceptions, are loved by God eternally and without limits. And there is nothing you can do to change that fact. The dream then finds expression as we reach out beyond ourselves by the power of the Spirit to love practically, tangibly, authentically, passionately, sacrificially, as Jesus did, so that the redemptive purposes of God will be served. That ultimately, I believe, is what the building project, the church, and your lives, my life, is all about. And so what role will you be playing in the redemptive purposes of God? Amen. Again, thank you so much for allowing me and inviting me to be a part of this special day.
Well, good morning. For me, it is a huge privilege to be able to be here today, riding on the coattails of all of you as we celebrate as a congregation this amazing gift of being able to be debt-free and have this tremendous facility here that allows us to do ministry here in our community and around the county and allows us to open this space for so many people to enjoy and to participate in different activities that help bring life and redemptive work to our community. So it is a great gift to be able to participate here today. And I just want to start by saying thank you. As Mike mentioned, the final annual meeting where the building committee was in place, these are the folks who were connected at that time. I'm sure there's a few other folks who were connected through the years as well. But those folks who were integrally involved were Bob Miller, Ray Bell, Nate Calderon, John Deason, Debbie Fezzemeyer, Asa Geiger, Charlie Goff, Bob Bradley, David Grover, Kurt Jones, Keith Krebs, Ron Mazzeo, Mindy O'Connor, Martin Perry, Bonnie Posner, Barb Snyder, Jerry Vanderbosch, Ben Penny Wilkin. So thanks to all of those folks who were on the committee. And thanks to Hillary and to Mike and all the work that they did as pastors to help foster and nurture that process along. And thank you to all of you, everyone who makes up this congregation that has participated in getting this building to be available to the community as a blessed place, as a place where redemptive work can take place. So today we celebrate and we give thanks that we get to move ahead, carrying on God's vision in the world for us. And this building is a big part of that. So as we prepare to burn the mortgage, let's join our hearts in prayer. God, we are grateful for your faithfulness that has allowed this building to come to fruition, to get to this place where it's not only built and being used by so many people, but it's also paid off. And so we're no longer in debt, and that burden isn't a part of our life anymore. And we can move into the future in new and beautiful ways because of being debt-free. And we are thankful for all of the generous giving that has made this a possibility. We celebrate your faithfulness in the midst of this. And God, today we particularly ask that you would be with us as we move into the future. We pray that you would give us wisdom. We pray that you would give us creative ways to serve you and to use this building to bring your redemptive work into our community. God, we celebrate your faithfulness, your grace, your mercy, and how you pour your grace and mercy into the world through us and through this place. And we celebrate all that you've done to make that a reality. Amen. I'm going to back out here and invite Hillary and Mike to step in here and burn this puppy up. God of twilight, Lord of day to night, spinner of the earth, O sunset painter, our hearts lift praises for the many blues you spread above us as the evening falls, pinks and reds projected on the clouds, and orange fire spilt across the mountains. Our souls sing out in thanks for all your colors. O God of sun and moon, king of the stars, the heavens praise you with each constellation, each silver point of light-year distant fire. More plenteous than sand grains by the sea, you've seeded the whole universe with sparkle. And more than these, as long ago you promised, and are all the twice-born children of the faith. O parents of the orphan and the childless, you who set the lonely into families, who draw the sad and timid into friendships, usher our injured souls into their healing. Give us eyes to see each other's beauty, and even the trust in you, and even the sour soul, so we might feed each other, crack us open, O Lord. God of the manger, the left out, the refugee, we give thanks for your constant love and grace. We celebrate that you truly are Emmanuel, a God who is with us. We are grateful that you are with our family and friends who are fighting the COVID virus right now. We pray for Doug and Katie Duckles, Richard and Ruth Blake, for five of Sharon Adcock's family, especially her granddaughter Sharon, who is extremely sick. We pray for Margaret Wilson as she has a second round of treatment this week. We pray your strength and be with you. O God of all eternity, we celebrate that you are always walking with us. Help us to trust in that truth each day, and let us join our hearts with the entire cloud of witnesses as we pray your prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now let all of us go from this place back into the to carry out God's redemptive will. To God be the glory, to the earth be peace, to Christians be courage, and to all people be hope. The peace of Christ be with each of you for this day and always. Blessings on your week, and thank you so much for being with us today to celebrate this great day of being able to burn the mortgage. Thank you, and let us go out to be God's redemptive Lord.